Good morning, and I'm very happy to be here, and I'm very pleased to see you, and I'm very grateful that you are going to dedicate at least part of this morning to listen to my rants. I want to be extremely grateful to the PRSSA, to the University of Maryland, to Dr. Tote, that I admire and cherish your friendships a long time, and to the students that work with me in preparing this lecture. They are very, very effective, efficient, intelligent, and suggest the beginning of all very good suggestions. And of course, I am honored and grateful my two mentors, Lauri and Jim. I love them both, and I've loved them for a long time. They've been very important for my work, and so I'm very happy and honored to be here. My principal argument today is that by deciding to professionally listen to and interpret specific stakeholder expectations before any relevant decision is taken in the organization, while it is being taken and implemented, and after it has been completed. Thus, deciding to operate in a communicating with framework, and we'll touch on that later on, where listening is more than 50% of the process, of the communication process. Each public, social, and private organization can accelerate the time of execution, as well as significantly improve its value and performance. From a management perspective, and despite its quantitative nature, the concept of time, seconds, minutes, days, months, years, is an essential qualitative variable for a management perspective. In fact, consolidated, repeated, and structural delays often end up in deteriorating the quality of decisions. And as much as we are biased when we attribute such deterioration mostly to public sector and public service organizations, we are, however, much aware, fully aware, that this happens equally in the private and in the social sectors of society. If I know what to expect and when from my key stakeholder publics on a certain and specific issue before I take it is likely that this information could influence the direction, when not the substance, of that very decision. And in any case, it leads me to anticipate and prepare for stakeholder reactions, actions, behaviors, thus avoiding that always-on, permanent crisis management mode that so many organizations complain about today. I submit, therefore, that the public relations function is better positioned than others in the organization to facilitate and govern this segment of the organization's decision-making process. But only if and when the function proves capable of practicing as well as disseminating, and this is essential, throughout the organization's culture, a communicating with stakeholders approach interpreted as a tool to improve the quality of relationships. Communication improves the quality of relationships. This is a tool. It's not an end to itself. And this, by developing, monitoring, and nurturing a professional infrastructure worldview, we'll get to that later on, based on solid foundations with ever-changing hard and soft variables. Nothing remains as it was only an hour ago. By guiding organizations in their transition from the legendary and mythical one company, one voice practice to a more productive and realistic one company with many voices, coherent one. And in an organizational scenario where the value created by intangible assets has greatly overtaken that of material assets, I argue also that the coordination of a continued, integrated, multi-channel, multi-stakeholder communicating with process is today the core and most valuable attribute of an effective public relations function. My lecture today is based on four specific topics. The qualitative impact of time and its relevance to public relations. The fundamental role of listening and its implications in the context of stakeholder relationships, governance, which I call core. It's the same word. The introduction of the infrastructure concept that I mentioned earlier, and the Janus approach, Janus being the ancient Roman pagan god with two heads, I'm sure you have it in your mind, by involving Janus approach to value creation in the organization by involving relatively new concepts, such as those of network society, relationship value networks, communicative equation, integrated thinking, integrated management, integrated reporting, all needed awarenesses for each one of you to be aware of. For any public relator who today believes that public relations is either practiced from a global perspective or is not. Many disciplines, from anthropology to sociology, from psychology to neuroscience, economics, management, and communication, of course, have tried to fathom the paradigm of time. The now and always on syndromes have today become part of our daily vocabulary in what appears to me, at least, to be a tacit coalition that sees our professional community acritically entrenched with a technology, connectivity, and communication are the barons of the 21st century, and by definition reluctant to any sort of global governance. We see this every day. A coalition that exasperates and exacerbates the value of now in the global public discourse to the point that we even begin to believe in our own mind. My argument instead is that this chronic, consubstantial perception of shortage of time and the inevitably consequential failure in understanding the concepts of yesterday, and therefore the concepts of tomorrow, more often than not leads to poor decision-making processes. There's one recent example that relates to many of you. I was facilitating group exercises with my master's youngsters this spring in New York. One of the groups, five people, was to select 20 entries from the Institute for Public Relations, which I'm sure you all know, huge data bank that students believe to, and I asked them to select 20 entries from this huge data bank. These entries were selected by them and because they were believed to be more attractive to their peers if summarized in 140 character tweets, so that they could send with a bit.ly link, so that the idea of the exercise was to stimulate my students to stimulate their peers to believe that research is essential for public relations practice. When they came with a selection of the 20 papers, they were all very good. I mean, the Institute of PR does not put stupid things on the website, so no comparison. But the point is that these 20 were all of the last 6 months. My first reaction was, okay, you've been lazy, you didn't have time, you didn't have time to get. But they said, no, professor, that's not the case. The case is that everything that is more than 6 months old is out. And I was absolutely shocked by this statement. I asked the student who told me, I asked the other students of the group, but do you agree with what he just said? Yes, professor. And this is really a wake-up call for us, not only for you, but also for us. And it's terrible, it's terrible, it's terrible. This now and always on society becomes the negation of yesterday, but consequentially, as I said, also of tomorrow. It's a self-inflicted damage for all of us, including those organizations we should be, as professionals, be supporting as they would rationally expect to move towards the future. There are many critics of this catastrophic approach. They say that this is only a paradox of affluence, that the diversity between the rich and the poor make the rich much more difficult to choose because many, many options. It's a technologically advanced society. So, I mean, you can describe the reasons for this in any possible way. However, it is very interpreted, there is little doubt that this perception deteriorates the quality of decision-making processes within the organization. I believe instead that an increased effort to listen to key stakeholder expectations on a relevant issue, not every issue, of course, but a relevant issue, before making any relevant decision, improves its quality. Some object that this exercise might cost time. But I argue that to the contrary, that if you carefully listen before deciding, you accelerate your implementation, and thus you create measurable added value to the organization. There are two traditional approaches, generally accepted, to how an organization in the best of circumstances approaches its relationship with stakeholder colleagues. And I believe that to become truly effective, these two need to blend. I know that Professor Grunig agrees only up to a certain point, but we will listen to his comment later on. The first is a symbolic interpretive approach, which is apparently dominant in practice, where the dedicated management function deals with how to protect, Jim would say, buffer, the organization from the environment, in distilling consolidated concepts such as, these are his words, such as image, identity, impressions, reputation, brand, and placing a major emphasis on publicity and media relations, mostly thought of in terms of messages and campaigns. Then there is the other one, which is the behavior strategical governance approach, which is emerging in practice, certainly is, as well as in the body of knowledge, where the same management function listens to and monitors if, when, how, and what stakeholders expect from the organizations, interprets those expectations, participating in the decision-making process as well as in the implementation of those decisions by involving and engaging key stakeholders in a planned process of continued integrated multi-channel, multi-stakeholder dialogue. This process inevitably implies that the function ensure that each relevant other management function in the organization be enabled with and supported by coherent communicated competencies and resources to create, develop, and consolidate its own stakeholder relationship networks. Every manager needs to have his own stakeholder relationship network. That's why I said before, one message, one voice is totally defunct, if I may use this term. In the context, however, of a global paradigm that entails that whatever and wherever organization operates, no generic principle, and I look at my friend here from Brigham Young University, Rob Wakefield, who's one of the earlier researchers and writers on this issue of this paradigm, and no specific application may operate independently. The generic principles are: one does not exist without the others. So the generic principles and the specific applications need to be totally integrated. So the first generic principle is you and then specific applications, and we'll see what these are. Then you acknowledge and monitor the value of stakeholder relationships. You enable the different operational management and strategic roles of the function with focus, obviously, on the latter if you are managing the whole thing. Acknowledge the role of diversity in general, but more importantly, this is essential, I think, as a specific stakeholder relationship asset, diversity. We'll see that later on. Define and uphold the values and unique characteristics of the organization with epigenetics, I say. Many people use the term DNA, but I have an elder son who is a biogenetic, and he tells me that DNA is a wrong term, it's epigenetics. And then you have the territorial specific applications, wherever you are in the world. And therefore, first of all, you embed the generic principles, as I said before, and then you monitor and interpret the institutional system, the political system, the economic system, the social cultural system, the active citizen system, and the media system. Just a brief parenthesis, I was having breakfast this morning with one of my best old friends, and I know that the name is not particularly popular in the PRSA or PRSSA, I guess, Jack O'Dwyer. And Jack told me this morning, he says, PR is dead. Corporate PR is defunct and buried. I said, yeah, well, read my lecture.
Gave him a talk.
So by blending the symbolic and strategic governance approaches I mentioned before, we can ensure a superior quality of decision making, an acceleration of its time of implementation, as well as, this is important, take a decisive step forward in the organization's corporate and marketing activities. Marketing is part of this activity. And that's where I imply the blending of the two systems. When they are, at least initially, you know that all these activities, at least initially, are necessarily push. They are communicating to. Because if you don't know who, you have to communicate to. And integrate this in a full communicating with stakeholder dialogue, and therefore become a pull that reinforces the organization's sustainability, relationships, and license. Listening. For me, listening is an ongoing process of receiving, constructing meaning from, and responding to a spoken, visual, and or nonverbal content. And it represents, in my view, in my experience, more than 50%, and is an inherent part of any communicative process. This is something we learn how to speak, we learn how to write, but we don't learn how to listen. And this is something which is not normally taught. Listening has many contexts. I list here some of the better known ones, only to give a general idea. Here they are. You have a desk analysis of the issue, analysis of the identity, and the influencing agents of key stakeholder groups, their alliances, their coalitions, collection of direct and indirect positions expressed on that issue by key stakeholder groups, one with one with few, one with many, telephone face-to-face conversation or digital exchange, participant observation, immersion, stakeholder network analysis, which is becoming more and more relevant, interviews, focus groups, offline, online, questionnaires, Delphi, or Delphi, which is probably more correct, tarot, trend analysis by relative opinion testing, which is what it means, and other polyquantitative paraphernalia which come out every day and the next day. These are rather required the organization to develop a specific ad hoc listening policy, keeping in mind the organization's unique epigenetic identity. This was done very well, at least an initial big step forward was done very well by the Global Alliance during the Melbourne mandate, which Ramadan was one of the relevant protagonists. The organization will need to adapt these tools to a true and unbiased understanding of stakeholder expectations relevant to the issue. And in some cases, this will lead the organization to change itself, as Jim often says, rather than, as many seem to believe, only adapt its communication behavior to those expectations. According to the practice of Italian psychiatrist Franco Basaglia in the 70s of the last century, and confirmed today by most neuroscientists, a true and unbiased understanding of the other, or as others, implies that the listener moves out of herself, himself, his ideas, biases, stereotypes, fixations. This is not an easy task. And objectively assemble verbal, visual, written, experiential contents from key stakeholder groups, in our case, if you were a patient, would be one individual, relevant to the issue, and that may impact on the organization's pursued objectives. The second phase is remaining in that removal mode. The listener returns to his or her key interlocutors with all the collected materials to seek added features and approval. And this has very much to do, if I may make a correlation, with the discussion which is going on now in all universities in this country about how to do research with human beings. And you know that this discussion is very prominent. The third phase, it has to do with transparency, just to give that thing. Returning into herself or himself, the listener interprets, together with other relevant management functions, which the organization is involved, the collective contents and their impact on the issue. This lesson I had learned that Taras seldom practice, unfortunately, and it's not a question of time, it's just a question of attention, that's how it is. From philosopher Gerardo Rovati, who was Bassanio's most authoritative interpreter, when he gave his keynote address at the 2005 World Public Relations Forum in Trieste, dedicated to communicating for diversity, with diversity, in diversity, a truly memorable event to some of us participating in this, that had been inspired and enormously stimulated by Lauri Grunig here, who is my mentor on this issue particularly. Now, in the mid-80s of the last century, when the two great persons sitting next to me today at this table, and to whose thoughts, as you have gathered so far, I owe so much, as they were developing their Exodus research, I was CEO of Italy's leading public relations agency. It was called SCR Society, and the company was doing very well. I felt the need to provide new, younger entries in the agency with a conceptual framework to allow them to better understand what they were doing and why. They would come in, they would be immediately, you know, these things will happen also to many of you. You will be immediately thrown in a desk, if you're lucky, somewhere, and do things, without thinking about what you're doing. And so, there were very few books there to learn from at the time. It was the mid-80s, and they were all in English, and my young people were mostly Italian, because I am Italian, the agency was Italian. So I asked four of our six business unit managers to take off a couple of months from the day-to-day work, we were doing well so we could afford it, and carefully review the last 60 projects the agency had executed, no matter what the issue, what the client, it doesn't matter, to see if there were and which these might be the commonalities of whatever implementation processes have been followed. We wanted to seek bottom-up the fil rouge about the first. So we came up, they came up, with a very practice-based idea, which led to the development of what we immediately called LORA. This is 87. Yeah, 87. Stands for Governance of Relationships. Whose end result, this was a surprise, we weren't looking for that, would also indicate a quasi-methodology to evaluate and measure the effectiveness of our work. And this is something which in the last 10 years has become, shall we say, dominant, at least in both of our colleagues, not in the days, but in the nights, yes. Basically, this approach implies that, okay, let's look at this. Let's see if I can do this well. No, I got it wrong. Help! Okay, so this is a graphic description of what I'm going to try to explain to you this morning. If you have that picture in your mind, and you during the day are doing your work and doing that, you say, where in the hell am I? What stage of this process am I in? Okay, an organization defines its mission, what it does and what it is about. Its vision, where it wants to be in a certain period of time, its guiding values, those that will drive the organization's actions and its journey from mission to vision, its strategy, the selected path to implement that trip, and its tactical objectives, intermediate objectives, if you like, those one-by-one achievements allow you to pursue the strategy. This is, in management speak, I work today with a consultant's management. We call that envisioning process. Then we argued with our clients that if these points were not clear as we began to operate, whatever, whether it was a press release or an event or a contest or whatever, the public relations professional should insist that they be clear to him, at least, or to her, and maybe also advise and support that very clarification process with the same client employed. Second comes the identification of the key stakeholder groups, so this is absolutely normal, you know this happens all the time. I differentiate from stakeholders and active stakeholders because they decide themselves to be so. They are not selected by the organizations. Other stakeholders, yes, but these are not selected. They decide themselves because they are aware of the organization's strategy and interested in playing a stake in its implementation, whether it's positive or negative. Third, the organization selects intermediate objectives to pursue its strategy as it moves forward, identifying potential stakeholders. In other words, publics that if they knew what I was up to, would be interested in playing a stake, negative, positive, whatever. And we decide who they are at this point, because we decide what we're going to be doing in implementing the strategy. So they become stakeholders, and the communicative mode here changes. So the first phase with the active stakeholders is mostly pulled. With the other stakeholders, if you have to tell them, you have to communicate too, and then going to communicating it mode, so it's push. And this reduces impact on the economics of public relations, of course, because if you need to communicate too, it's more expensive, usually. Not all the time, usually, yes. Fourth, one identifies opinion leaders selected by the organization because they believe to be influential, they believe to be influential in disseminating arguments in support, as well as issue influencers who instead have a direct influence or indirect on the dynamics of those external issues which are not relevant for the trade, which are not dominated by the organization, but by regulations, by technology, by the development of the financial markets, etc., etc., etc. And all these have an enormous influence and enormous importance for the organization. All these publics, and they often overlap, it happens very often, that an active stakeholder is also a potential stakeholder, is also a opinion leader, is also a... That this is an important, how would you say, exercise that needs to be done, because otherwise you forget the most important one. That's what happens most of the time in my experience. So far, arriving to the third, yes, here we are, involving, we are talking about a management process. This involves many management functions, not only the other. Then all these different publics, we involve many other functions as well as the public relations. Sorry. At this point, the public relations professional gets really to work and prepares arguments, contents, selects communicative channels, and tools to open or get involved in a dialogue with and amongst any one of those publics. Also by providing and incentivizing feedback mechanism. This obviously is much more possible today than it was 30, 40, or 30 years ago, there's no doubt about that. However, before pressing the go button, the professional undertakes a pretest on a random sample of specific intended publics to understand both the communicative quality and the relationship quality. The communicative quality is usually, in my case, we measure them on three indicators. The credibility of the source, if a message comes from, how credible is it, 0 to 10. The credibility of the content, if this content comes from you, how credible is it, 0 to 10. And the familiarity with the content. I mean, if I know everything about the content, and even more than the message says, it's useless to communicate. If I know nothing, it's also useless to communicate because I don't attract the attention. So you have to be very careful in balancing that. And then, of course, the quality of the relationship, because that is the end objective of what of our existence. Levels of trust, commitment, satisfaction, power balance in the specific relationships, and we all of us work to the University of Maryland and to our friends here at the table and down there. If it hadn't been for them, we wouldn't be here today, so I'm very, very happy to say this. The results of this pretest also allows the professional to set up specific communication and relationship objectives to be achieved in a given amount of time with given human and financial resources, and allows him or me to negotiate with my client or employer a bonus if I exceed, a penalty if I don't the local objective, and this really creates a wonderful relationship with the client or with the employer if you are able to argue like this. When the rollout is concluded, and I won't even touch on the rollout because you are all experts in the rollout, and I'm not going to give you any more, you know more about it than I do because you are up to date with all the technology and all that. Then you do a post-test with another random sample of the same universe along the same lines as the pre-test, and therefore you can measure or at least evaluate, I wouldn't use the term measure, I prefer the term evaluate, if and where the program has been more effective. This process has been obviously revised many times since we developed it in 87, but it's still extremely valid, and it's being more and more used by professionals, agencies, organizations, and with great satisfaction. I mentioned the term infrastructure. I use this term, which is unfamiliar in public relations, because infrastructure is material. To define an articulated conceptual space where a well-intentioned observer may perform a fairly comprehensive and guided tour of the different cultural, intellectual, and professional components, I believe that a contemporary public relations practitioner needs to at least have in mind, be aware of. The term infrastructure is itself provocative because it has a connotation of materiality. That voluntarily conflicts with this, the fluffy, vaporware, abstract stereotypes normally associated with our profession. Let's take a look. Underneath, go down to the bottom. You have, there's a term missing, Stockholm Accord. The terrain of the infrastructures are the two most recent Stockholm Accords of 2010, Melbourne Mandate of 2012. I am aware that there's a new one of a couple of weeks ago that was developed in Madrid. This is my first forum that I've ever been to, that I've not been to, and I'm very sorry not to have done that, but I know this is the third document which has come out, which is on the same lines as these. These are developed by many professional associations and implemented of the Global Alliance, with some, the Global Alliance has about 180,000 individual members. So it's TRSA times 67, something like that. Obviously, TRSA is the largest one, but still. These are documents based on collective efforts by hundreds of scholars and professionals from around the world who attempt to describe the purpose, the value, and the principle today of public relations in society and in social, public, and private organizations in particular. These documents constitute the fertilizer, the foundation of the infrastructure. On the two sides, you have the two things that I just mentioned. On one side, the generic principles and specific applications. On the other side, the law. And then you have a big central pillar that comes up. And these are the two generally accepted approaches to public relations, which are progressively, inevitably, whether we like it or not, emerging or blending in the sense that I indicated before. And then from there on the left, you have all the traditional specialities of public relations, but don't misunderstand me, these are traditional, but they change every day. Every day, each one of these has different ways, different knowledge, different curiosities, different applications, so you have to be very aware of what's going on. On the other side, instead, are the ones that are less developed, less consolidated, and that the global body of knowledge is doing a lot of work over the last 2-3-4 years, maybe, in trying to get hold of and trying to make organizations, professionals, and obviously educational opportunities involved in this decision. So, if you put this together, I would say I put this all together the other day when I opened my class in the Vatican last week, last 2 days. And I started the course from here. If you want to take a perusal of what the hell is going on in our profession, start from this, okay? So, then there's another, and I think it's probably the last.
Yes.
Okay, the Yarns approach. Okay, just very quickly, until 20 years ago, corporate accountants and financial analysts and the stock exchanges of the world considered that the value of organizations was 70% material and 30% immaterial or intangible, i.e. Patents, intellectual property, reputation, brand, what, however you want to call all these things that we've been talking about. What's happened in the last 20 years is that thing has completely rebalanced. It's 70% now at least intangibles and 30% material. Now, this is a revolution, a real revolution that very few people think about, but it has an enormous impact on the organization's value creation. And the growth of this and the growth, and of course this change is due to globalization and to the fuel of globalization. However we like it or not, it is communication. This, as Anthony Giddens theorized in our book, the world's most cited sociologist, Lord Anthony Giddens. this forceful and dramatic change has to do with the consequences of globalization, as well as the growing awareness that internal and state external stakeholders require that organizations inform them regularly, constantly. As it happens, the traditional organization chart separating line and staff is defunct. It does not exist anymore. It does on paper, but nobody really takes it seriously anymore. So, basically, there's a new management, and I finish here, there's a new management discipline, which is called integrated thinking, that implies the alignment and continued interaction between all the functions of the organization. It implies the blurring of all silos. It implies the constant development of a new taxonomy, or language, if you like, that allows a process of ongoing, continued, multi-channel, multi-stakeholder, and integrated dialogue with stakeholders. Now, I have two or three more pages, but I'm not going to go through them. There's one last concept that I did not cite, which is that of the communicative equation. This thing is online now, this whole lecture, so you can download it and look at it, because I think the last part is also very interesting. I am very grateful to all of you for having, shall we say, supported me. not supported me is a positive term. In Italian it means bear with me, shall we say. So if you have survived so far and taken your time to listen to things, I have today, in the first part of my lecture, covered the chronic time pressure how it deteriorates the quality of organizational decisions. I have argued that listening to stakeholders before, during, and after the decision-making process improves the quality and accelerates its integration, and I also illustrated how listening can be rationalized and why organizations should have their own listening calls. In the second part, I addressed the dynamics of the governance of relationship approach, the motivations behind the infrastructure concept, and did not conclude with the introduction of the communicative equation. I am extremely grateful for your patience, and I know I'm going to have to do something at the end, and I hope that you listen, and I hope that I'm very curious to hear what Lauri and Jim are going to comment, and I'm going to sit down and take notes, and thank you for your patience. This is online from this morning. It's, you can write down the you are nothing to do with this lecture, although it does have in the appendices the full copy of the lecture. It's an online book of my professional memoirs, 54 years of profession, and also it's 74 years, in fact, much of my youth, and so it's personal and professional autobiography. I know I have my companion in life is a contemporary political historian, and she has refused to even open a page of this thing, and so and had a struggle time. Anyway, that's for your perusal. Thank you very much.
I was thinking it's been almost 10 years since I retired from teaching, and automatically I went back to those years and was thinking, what's her name? I've got to memorize one row at a time with these names in the lecture hall. Then I realized I know only a handful of them anyway, but it's delightful to see a group of students here. And I'm sure that you join me in thanking Professor Muzi Falconi for joining us. This is a very special occasion because he is the first of the seven lecturers in this series who has come from outside of the U.S. But rather than thinking of Toni as a European or an Italian, I always regard him as a citizen of the world. He has lived everywhere, he's lectured everywhere, he is loved everywhere, and he's chosen to make this transatlantic trip to speak with us all today. We are really, really privileged. I listened to what you said, Toni, and to me, it all boils down to, and this is virtually a Twitter feed, listening is important. Right? Gotta remember that. Listening is important. And if you're the kind of public relations student that many of mine were, the kind of student who says, well, I'm a wordsmith, I'm not a numbers cruncher, you might be resistant to those research classes that are typically required of you in your journey to become a public relations professional. But if you think of research as listening, the way that Professor Muzi Falconi explained it, then I think it's a little easier to swallow those research classes and those dreaded exams and team projects in research. Because remember, listening is just systematic. Listening is research that is done systematically. Okay, so what did we listen to today? I want you to think, if you will, is this true? Is all this true, which Professor Muzi Falconi has said? I think a more relevant question, though, is it true for me? Did it have the ring of truth as you listened? In my experience, listening is fundamental not only to public relations, but to life. And the complicated thing about that is that we have been socialized differently in our lives. Look at the diversity of this group on every dimension you can think of, not just gender, not just race, class, culture, and so forth. And socialization affects the way we talk and the way we listen. Just last week, Amanda Bennett wrote an op-ed piece in the Washington Post, and some of you who live in the area here might read the Post. I'm just going to read from the final paragraph in her op-ed piece that was called Women Speak Up. She said, I had been at a dinner party and sat next to a man for a couple hours, and at the end of this event, she turned to the fellow and said, we've been at dinner for 2 hours, and I know everything about you. I know where you went to school, how you got into business, but you don't know one single thing about me, and why not? Well, his matter-of-fact answer, I talked and you listened. He didn't deny he wasn't listening, but neither was I speaking. I had a voice, I just wasn't using it. So, I'm using my voice today, and I can't use it very long because Jim wants to say something this too. But just a word for the women out there, you know, we've got voices, we have been socialized, many of us, to listen. And men, by contrast, not that there are any essential differences, but socialization needs some people to do more talking and some to do more listening. To me, one of the most intriguing aspects of our lecture today was Professor Muzi Falconi's allusion to the god Janus. I'm going to say Janus because I want to make the link with what we know about this two-headed ancient pagan god. I kind of wish the conference were being held in January because that's where we get the name of that month, from Janus. Think too of janitor. That's where the name janitor, where the word janitor comes from. If you are of a Christian background, you know of St. Peter, the gatekeeper, and he is frequently called the janitor of heaven, because that's what janitor initially meant, a gatekeeper. And we have that role in public relations often, more of a rotary, really, between publics and the organization. Anyway, there is a connection between Janus and October, as well as January, because in ancient times, October was the month when the military season, the wars, ended. The battle season started in March, it ended at the end of October, and would that that happened today, we can see an end to the site. Well, Janus was considered the father of all the gods, and he is associated with war, with battles, with the military. He is for sure a masculine god. So as I consider this year's Grunig Lecture, I kind of yearn for an extension of this metaphor, or maybe even a substitution of the metaphor of Janus, whom Toni calls so clearly the blood circulation of the organization in the public relations function. And the shift I have in mind is consistent with the diversity that our lecture alluded to. He acknowledges the centrality, the absolute necessity of valuing diversity for relationships and communication. And he doesn't mean just paying lip service to these concepts. Nor does he mean gender alone. For example, of course, there is cultural difference, diversity, especially around the concept of time, I think, and now and tomorrow. These are culturally bound. In MBA classes in the United States, for example, students are typically required to develop a long-term plan for their career, a plan of 10 years or even 5 years. But in much of Asia, that would be a very short-term plan. For us, I think 10 years is a very long time to look ahead. So in that spirit of diversity, and only partly tongue-in-cheek, I ask you all to consider what difference it would make if, to Professor Muzi Falconi's treatise, if we substitute Juno for Janus. These two gods are often associated in mythology, and they have a lot of common features and functions. Like Janus, for example, Juno was supposed to be warlike, but she was also considered a protector and a special counselor of the state and the community. And if you saw the 2007 film Juno, anybody see that one? Love that show. About the quirky pregnant teenager, you know that she also represents youth and vital force. Okay. Well, I'd like to thank the public relations professionals, the majority of whom, of course, are women these days, in the same way, strong, youthful, if only in willingness to consider diverse perspectives. You don't have to be young to be open to new ideas. And helping safeguard both their organizations and the milieu in which they operate. We must listen to learn to, learn to listen, rather, to all of our stakeholders in and outside of the organization, and we must not discount what we hear simply because it is different from what we already think. Long-term viability of any organization, as we learned today, relies in large part on taking the time to listen before, during, and after making any significant decisions. Well, one of the best decisions was when Dr. Toth, Professors Richard Toth and Grant, Susan Simon, and the wonderful PRSSA team invited Professor Toni Muzi Falconi to share his wisdom with us. And I was listening. Thank you.
Well, the most important thing I learned from Toni is that anything over 6 months old is out. So therefore, I have nothing to say. I've been retired for 9 years, and I haven't written anything new in a long time. But anyway, I'll speak anyway. But I'm struck listening to Toni speak, because in professional public relations circles today, we hear a lot about the failure of public relations professionals to measure what they're doing, to measure the outcomes, to prove that they have some value, and so on. Many times I've written that the bigger problem than the failure to measure is the failure to conceptualize. That is, to think about what you're doing, why you're doing it, and what you expect to happen as a result, both before and after measuring something. See, lots of people running about measuring things without any idea why they're measuring it, only because some outside firm makes a measure available to them. Now, Toni is a rare example of a practitioner who conceptualizes and measures. He's an avid consumer of academic theory and research, as well as a conceptualizer himself. He didn't promote his other book today, but you can find ample evidence of his ability to conceptualize in a book that's available online also, Global Stakeholder Relationships Governance. He's an Italian, so we'll pardon all the stack modifiers. In infrastructure and in his Gorel model, which I think is a very advanced piece of theorizing. But because this is a student group today, I'd like to start with Toni's interpretation of the difference between the symbolic interpretive and the strategic management functions of public relations. I've written a lot about this, and in fact, I'm supposed to write an article before the middle of December defining these two, so it's good to think about them. But most undergraduate students like yourselves are interested in public relations, in my experience, mostly because they want to do the symbolic interpretive approach. They're interested in messages, creativity, campaigns, slogans, and especially today by using the social media and other digital media. Wonderful ways to put out messages, to interpret things, to give make people interested in organizations and so on. Well, early in your career, most of you will be doing mostly symbolic interpretive things. That's what entry-level positions usually are about. But I think that if you think of Toni's integrating the symbolic interpretive with strategic management approaches by moving from communicating to communicating with, then you have to begin to think, not how am I going to get my message out, but how am I going to involve and interact with the most important publics. That concept, communicating with, is made much easier today because of digital and social media. It's, although it's a lot of fun to communicate to, it's also really easy to listen to social media. I think Toni's expansion of the listening concept beyond interpersonal communication to include research and analysis is also made easier by the digital media. You can do research, you can listen in digital media by listening to what other people say, by organizing and analyzing what they're saying and reporting that back to management, and not just getting nice messages out and creating messages out in the digital media. Next point, I think, if you do symbolic interpretive work, it should be framed by what Toni calls the communication infrastructure. Not just how to manage individual communication messages or programs or campaigns, but how to think about and organize profession, what is the profession about, and how the organizational function should be organized and developed to make multi-stakeholder interaction possible. So without understanding this kind of infrastructure, which unfortunately many people who come into the public relations profession without formal academic education have no idea what that infrastructure is. Now, I'd like to move on from that and talk just a little bit about Toni's theorizing and what I think he's accomplished. A number of concepts he's taken from the existing academic literature, many of which I'm familiar with. In addition, first of these are the symbolic interpretive and strategic management functions. But he's also introduced the concept of global and specific principles, that the principles of public relations are, it could be, the same around the world, but they have to be specifically applied in different situations. Robert Wakefield is the father of this concept, and he's sitting here in the front row. I think he's also integrated the concepts of great relationships and reputation as intangible assets. The most important thing that public relations contributes to an organization are these intangible assets. He's conceptualized stakeholders and publics in how do you identify them and how do you interpret what they're saying. And he's taken the concept of symmetrical communication and defined that as communicating with, which probably would be more acceptable to the critical scholars who have not symmetrical communication. But in addition to integrating these two paradigms, the listening framework, the communication infrastructure, and this Grunig model, Toni has integrated several other original concepts with these that can be found in the academic literature. I'm most struck by his notion of integrated reporting as a part of organizational governance. You can find that in his book. But instead of just putting out an annual financial report, organizations should report their relationship quality, their social responsibility, their sustainability, and so on. And this is not just one annual report, but it's an ongoing process of communicating with stakeholders. The part that he, I think, is one of the most interesting things is the part we didn't get to because I think you wanted to leave time for it. The concept of a network society that he borrows from João Duarte, a Portuguese scholar who is, as he points out in his written speeches, a brilliant and important young man. There's a controversy often when we public relations scholars go to Europe and we talk about the interest of publics or stakeholders or the importance of organizations identifying their stakeholders and specifically communicating to them and being responsible to them. In Europe, they want to be responsible to all of society and often accuse me of being unethical because I'm not concerned about society and not specific stakeholders. Well, through the concept of a network society, it's sort of the light bulb came on to me. You can integrate both of these concepts. If you think of an organization being embedded in a very large network of other organizations and stakeholders and publics, and all of these together make up society, that you can communicate and be responsible to society by working through the stakeholders that are relevant to or concerned about your organization. So by thinking of this network society, I think we can resolve this difference between American and European thinking and scholarship. Well, in conclusion, I've been honored to have known Toni for many years. I've forgotten how many, but I just remember one evening in Milan in which we were all going out to dinner and we hadn't met him for the first time. And here he was standing and along the street in the piazza. And that's the first time we met him. I had no idea who he was or why he was interested in meeting us. So it's been an honor to have him deliver a lecture in our honor and for the original thinking that he has contributed to the paradigm that Lauri and I and many other public relations scholars have worked on for 50 years, not just 6 months. Thank you.